Ephesians in chapter 4. We've done verses 1 and 2. And just at the end of 2, he says here that we should be making allowances because you love one another. And he goes on then and talks about how we should be living our life in the Spirit and in the presence of the Lord. But love is the bond. Love is that which makes it happen. So you and I need to be always looking out for one another and lifting one another up, exalting one another, encouraging one another, because without that bond of love, nothing will work. Nothing will be homogeneous. It'll all be a problem for us. And in verse 3, he talks here and says, be eager and strive earnestly to guard and keep the harmony and oneness of produced by the Spirit in the binding power of peace. In the first instance, he says, be eager. And then he says, strive earnestly. You know, it's good to be eager about certain things in our lives. It's good to be eager about the faith. It's good to be eager about lost souls. And it's good to be eager about praying. And it's good to be eager about reading the Word of God. But there is more to it. He says, be eager and put that into action, earnestly striving to do what I'm about to tell you. And that is where usually a baby Christian gets up and follows something like that. They get excited about being eager in the kingdom. They were excited about striving after this new life they have in the kingdom. But in time, these individuals can be churched. And then when they're churched, that eagerness is quenched and that earnest striving is quenched, because you can become quite comfortable. You can enter into a state of being inside a cocoon where it is nice and warm and cuddly, and you don't have to concern yourself, because you look around and you see in your environment people are only eager after certain things that make them feel good, or certain things in the church that they want to do. But he is saying here, the most important thing is to love one another, be earnestly seeking after that, striving after that, striving after the harmony, striving after the oneness, which is produced by the Spirit of power who lives within you. Now, God thinks it's important enough that the Holy Spirit's motive in us is to create this atmosphere in our hearts, this eagerness, this desire to strive earnestly, to guard what we have in the Holy Spirit, to guard what we have in God, and to keep a harmony between ourselves in oneness, working together with the Holy Spirit, produced by the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit is put in our hearts and in our lives as a binding power that produces peace between us. Now, if that exists, then the world is concerned. The world would look at a very powerful move of people. And so it's very important for us to realize that this verse is to encourage and motivate and bring us to that place. So once again, just going back over that, be eager, strive earnestly, guard, keep or preserve harmony and oneness, which is produced by the Spirit, and He will bind it together in power, and He will produce peace. I think God's trying to bring upon us this harmony and consistency so that He can do things the way He wants to do them. If we allow ourselves to learn to be submissive in this way, the world will indeed be startled by the Christian love. And I think it was Jesus who said they will know us by our love for one another. And that love is not something we have to work on and do alone. The Holy Spirit comes into us, and the Holy Spirit makes us eager. The Holy Spirit teaches us to strive earnestly. The Holy Spirit teaches us to guard that which is precious before God. The Holy Spirit teaches us to keep harmony with one another. and to be one in what we are doing together. And that will bond us together and will produce peace. So when troubles begin to occur in a church where there is a gathering of Christians, I believe what happens is they have not been listening to the Holy Spirit. They have stopped reading the Word. They have stopped studying the Word. And their innermost man is not being fed. And thus they begin to do the things that are carnal. And when Paul writes to the Corinthians in the first letter, he clearly states to them, you are yet not spiritual, you are yet still carnal. In the second letter, he writes to them and improves that by saying that they have matured. They are beginning to move on. They are more spiritual than they were before. So there is progress. And if we make ourselves available to the Holy Spirit, and we make ourselves available to one another, we can progress. We're not islands. We're part of the body of Christ. He is the head. Some of us are feet, some of us are elbows, some of us are arms, some of us are legs. But we're working together for the goal that God has for his kingdom in our lifetime. He knew our lifetime would come about, and he planned before the foundation of the world that our involvement in his call in our lifetime would bring about a greater growth of the kingdom of God, a greater influence of the kingdom of God. So we're all important to one another as much as we're all important to God. But if we don't listen to the Spirit striving with us, earnestly trying to get us to follow this harmony that we can have in him, which produces this power and produces this peace, we're wasting God's time and we're wasting our own. God wants us to be energized by the Holy Spirit in a mighty way. In a mighty way. And it's not easy. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it all the time. But when persecution comes, when troubles come, when difficulties come to the church, worldwide or locally, there's an incredible harmony that comes together, and we just work better in the kingdom of God. We lift one another up better. We're more conscious spiritually than we are when times are good, when times are easy, and we're hiding in our churches, and we're hiding in our workplace, and we're hiding in our homes, and we're not out there sharing the gospel because we're comfortable in our zone. When that happens, this doesn't occur. This doesn't happen. But we need to seek for it. So I don't know about you, but I think it's a challenge to, first of all, set for eagerness, to be eager to do this loving amongst ourselves, and also to strive earnestly to guard this harmony we'll produce when we do love one another. When we've got that, we work together, we have this incredible environment in which people will come in and they'll be astounded. Now, we know a lot of people out there in the world. We know that what they need in their lives is Jesus Christ. We know that he will bring them together. We, particularly the group that hangs out with me and we go off and disciple in certain areas, we know a man who has hardly any friends. And he's always talking about, no one befriends me, nobody comes to visit me. And yet right there on his back door is a group of people that want to love him and want to share with him and do love him and do share with him, but they want to see also that the Holy Spirit comes to live within him so he can understand this wonderful bonding of the Spirit that we have in Christ Jesus, this harmony we have together in the kingdom of God. And so because of that pain that he's suffering, we in our hearts are reaching out for him. We're striving to do all that we can to share with him the good news and to share with him our lives so that he will come unto the kingdom of God and receive the Holy Spirit, and he will then have this power, this binding power in his heart, this loving power in his heart, this peace in his heart, which comes only from the Holy Spirit. There's nothing in the world you can do to create this. This all comes from the Holy Spirit. Amen. You need a glass, cup of water, you right?
That's water.
I usually have some lozenges to fix that, but I haven't got them with me. I've used them all up. Gave me somebody the other day who had the same problem. I think it was Jeff Hocking.
It was.
They worked, didn't they?
They did.
And then you haven't got any with you, have you?
No.
I'd usually carry them in my car. Now, verse 3 carries on, of course, into what we've divided up, verse 4, but it's the same emphasis of the Spirit working in our lives. He says, there is one body and one Spirit, just as there is also one hope that belongs to the calling you received. The one body he's referring to here, of course, is the body that Paul refers to in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, which is the body that is called the kingdom. That is the body of Christ. We are the makeup of that body now. He is the head, and we make up the rest of the body. We are joined to the head, we come under the head, and that is possible through love. It's possible because we love him, and he has chosen to come and live within us, and we are one body. Sad that the world doesn't see that. What the world sees is a very divided kingdom. It's all different denominations going in all different directions who can't get together as often as they should, working together as one. I look at these towns that I go to, and there might only be several hundred people in some of them, and there could be 5,000 other people in another place. And in those towns, you have 15 churches or 15 different groups doing their own thing. We can do better than that. We can come together. We can work together. We can be reaching out for the town together if we allow the Holy Spirit to do that. And he is only one. It's clear there. And one Spirit. Therefore, if he is one in us, we will all do what he wants done. But if we have our own desire and our own will and our own purpose in the kingdom of God, to only call upon the Holy Spirit to accompany us to the work, then we'll always have these divisions. But if we get together as one and we seek what God wants us to do in that community, in that town, in that country, and it's not just for a great celebration time and a lot of singing and dancing, but it's a sincere effort to lay down our lives for the glory of the kingdom, then we will see great things happen. We will see mighty things happen because the Spirit will be leading us. The Spirit will be guiding us. If we believe the Holy Spirit doesn't talk to us and lead us from within our hearts and in our souls, but only through the Word of God, then we have major problems also because, oh, I interpret the Word different from the way you interpret the Word. And if you don't follow the way I follow the Word, then you're not going to make it. And we're the only ones going to heaven. And so it goes. And that's not good. That does not win battles. That's like taking the Australian Army or the American Army or the British Army and putting it in a battlefield and telling it to do whatever it wants to do, whenever it wants to, in its own interpretation, and just go for it as you want to. Well, that wouldn't last very long. Armies are set up in such a way that there is a command, and that command is responsible. It heads up what goes on. Well, we've been put in this place to go out and to love the world and to bring them to attention, to repent, and to obey the gospel. And the Holy Spirit has been given to us to live within us, to enable us to go out there and to bring them in. And if we bring them in, we also have the instruction on how, when they come in, they live and how we can work together, because we see that back in verse 3. He says, be eager when you come into the kingdom of God to live this way. Be earnest about it. Strive for it. Because if you don't, then the world's not going to get it. The world's not going to see it. And then he goes on, he says, just as there is also one hope that belongs to the calling you received. Now the calling, of course, is the gospel call. And neither the calling nor the gifts of the Holy Spirit have been revoked. Romans 11:29 tells us that. So when I come to the calling of God, I receive the Holy Spirit also. When I obey the gospel in all of the aspects of it, belief, repentance, confession, baptism in water, the Holy Spirit comes to live within me. I receive the Holy Spirit. It's the desire of the Holy Spirit that I then begin to become eager and strive and earnestly for a harmony between me and the other brothers in the kingdom of God and sisters in the kingdom of God whom the Holy Spirit dwells. And that we work together in the same hope. We bring to the world hope. The world needs hope. People need hope, and we have the hope the world needs. And if we allow the Holy Spirit who lives within us to bring the good news to them, in which is retained the hope of God, we will bring them into a place where they can wake up every day knowing that all things are possible, all things have been solved, and they will have great hope. When a person is not well, and Ian deals with them all the time in regard to the chaplaincy in the hospitals and elsewhere in the hospice. And, they're at the end of their lives. The only thing that you can bring to that person is the hope through your own faith. And you bring them to a place where you say there is indeed life after death. And they want to know about your hope. When I was in China, I was working with another faithful servant of the Lord. I was at the Statistics University in the city of Xi'an, and he was at the major hospital in the city of Xi'an, and he was teaching the students there English. And I asked him one day, I said, how did you get converted? And he said, I was working as a healthcare nurse in a nursing home. And there was this man who was in his mid-90s, about 93, 94, who used to come down every morning for breakfast, and he would bring his Bible with him, and he would sit down at the table, and he would put his Bible in front of his bowl and never open it. He would eat his breakfast. One day I got curious why he brought his Bible with him and put it in front of him while he ate his food. He said, he never looked up at me. He just put his finger over and placed it on the Bible and said, hope. He said, because that man at 93, 94 years of age pointed to the Bible and was happy within himself that he had hope, I wanted to find out what it was. So he said, I then began to read the Bible. When I began to read, I found the hope that the old man had, and I became a Christian. Simple. One word brought that man to become a missionary into China. One word. Just like the word eternity, which has been written all over the streets of Sydney, on the Sydney Harbour Bridge, and is reported now as an evangelistic tool where thousands upon thousands of people have seen it, millions of people have seen it, just one word. And so when I think of hope, I think of that occasion when that man in China told me that his conversion was based on the hope of another. And I know that when I'm evangelizing people, and I'm talking about every person I meet every day, I'm striving for the opportunity to bring them the hope, somehow or other, that I have in Jesus Christ. I'm looking, I'm listening, I'm waiting for the right moment to bring them to attention so that they will know the hope that dwells within me. And when they tell me that they don't believe, I don't have a problem with that. I strive then to pray for them, if I'm going to meet them again, and bring them to attention to the hope that I have. If they say to me, I don't know if I could have the same hope that you have, I tell them, yes, you can. And not only because it's a religious thing, but because it's a very personal thing to me. I know it. I know him in whom I have believed. And I know that he is able to do that which I am unable to do. And not only when I'm alive, but when I'm dying or when I'm dead, he is able to do that which he promises. And what he promises me is life He who believes in me shall never die. That's a wonderful, exciting thing. And so that's the hope I have. I don't have a problem looking somebody in the eye and telling them, I believe in Jesus. I have no doubt about it at all. I have complete trust. And therefore, that's what my hope is built on. And so here he says, there is also one hope that belongs to the calling you received. So what we're bringing to the world is something that they want, which is hope. If they buy a lotto ticket on Sunday morning, or Monday morning, or Tuesday morning, in the Saturday lotto draw, for the whole week they're believing they're going to win, in the sense of, I hope I win. What they're doing is worshipping the God of chance, which was an Old Testament God. This hap, this is where we get our word happiness from, comes from a god that was called Hap. And so happiness meant he blessed you. By chance, you were a winner. I don't live like that. I'm a winner every day. I have been provided for. If he's providing for me now in the flesh, I know he will provide for me in the spirit. So my hope is founded upon experience as well as truth. I believed what I read, I applied it, and I experienced results. That's what we do as Christians. We read the word, we take it out, we put it into practice, we come away excited because we experienced it. Just before the class began, we had a little question time. What has God been doing for you during the week that's exciting? Now that is taking faith, putting it into action, seeing the results, experiencing the hope. And so when the Holy Spirit lives within me, he's wanting me to be excited. He's wanting me to be hopeful. No matter how gloomy things are, how bad things look, we have hope. And sometimes it gets so depressing when we look around the world, we see all the news, we wonder how we're going to get on, how we're going to get through. And we seem to lose our hope. The best thing to do is go back to the word that was written by the Holy Spirit and get down on the knees and just wait on the Lord. Not for something to happen, but just to know his presence and the confidence that he assures us comes through his Holy Spirit. That's discipline. That's discipleship. That's what God wants us to do. Then he goes on, he says in verse 5, there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and 6, one God and Father of us all. Put those two together, 5 and 6. And so in the first instance, he doesn't say there is one Jesus. He says there is one Lord. He doesn't say there is one Savior. He says there is one Lord. He doesn't say there is one teacher. He says there's one Lord. He doesn't say there's one master. He says there's one Lord. Now that's a significant point because some people love to have Jesus as their Savior, but they don't want him as their master, their teacher, or their Lord. Some people want Jesus to always be Jesus of Nazareth, walking through the flowers with a little lambie in his arms and the sheep following him around amongst the wonderful pasture that the artists would depict and often do in Sunday school teaching. But once we come to Christ and we give our lives in a total, complete way, earnestly seeking, eagerly seeking to be in harmony with the Holy Spirit and one another, we allow Jesus to become the Lord of our lives. And then the hope that we have through the calling gets to become an experience. Because instead of us being those who can do everything, we know we can't, And we entrust ourselves unto him who is Lord over all things, through all things. And we give our trust to him, and then we experience his lordship. So all the circumstances before us, whether it be by employment problems, home problems, mortgage problems, money problems, all of these problems that may come against us, all of these affronts that may come against us, all of the troubles that may come against us in the flesh, are overcome because we trust the Lord who has lived in the flesh, understanding how it was to live in the flesh. And if these troubles are from the spiritual realm, from the principalities and the powers outside of the flesh that come against us, we can trust him in that because he's given us authority in his name to overcome, and he has overcome all principalities, all powers, all mights, no matter where they are, whatever dimension they're in. He already has won them. And so what we can do is go to him and trust him as our Lord. And as servants, which we are, bonded to our Lord, we entrust ourselves to him, and he's the only one that we learn to love and to desire. Now, if we're not walking in harmony with one another, as we saw back there in verse 3, and this love of the power of the Holy Spirit, or the love of the Spirit within us, creates this binding power between us, and we can't harmonize together, we can't work for the Lord, because we're jealous, we're envious, we're striving after our own glory, we're trying to supersede each other in some way or other, we're trying to usurp our authority over each other, we're trying to bring each other down that we might be glorified. All of that is of the world, it's all carnal, and it tells us that we haven't submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Because the Lordship of Jesus Christ was brought to the attention of the disciples when they said, who is the greatest in the kingdom? You see, they had that desire to be the man or the woman. They had that desire to be the recognized famous one. And Jesus clearly pointed to John the Baptist and said, John the Baptist is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. He who is least in the kingdom of heaven is better or more honored than John the Baptist. What he was referring to was what he talked about back here, where a person who loves will never strive to exalt themselves. They will always be striving to exalt other people. They'll always be striving to allow the Holy Spirit to take control of them. They'll always be submitting themselves to the Lordship of Jesus. They'll always come under his submission. They will do what he wants. And they won't ask questions. And they'll trust him. If he has that power over all dimensions, surely he's able to take care of that which he calls us to. True? Isn't he the one that said, do not be anxious about what you shall eat, what you shall drink, what you shall wear? Didn't he also say, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, and all these things shall be added unto you? All these things. Why? Because he is the Lord. So we have one Lord, and his name is Jesus. Then he says, one faith. Now we can become all doctrinal here, and we can begin to say which faith is the one faith. And we can begin to say we are of the true faith, and you're not. I've been there, seen that happen, even done it, and it's not what God wants. What God wants of us is to have the same faith that Jesus had when he was living on the earth. And that comes from total surrender. Paul reached that place. In Galatians 2:20, he clearly states that it was no longer him that was living. It was Jesus who was living in him, in the same faith he had when he was upon the earth. Now that's the one faith that we're called to, that faith of Jesus. I must learn to harmonize with the faith of Jesus. Therefore, I've got to get to know him. And I've got to learn to know him as my Lord. Because I want to have that same faith. I want to go through what he went through to please his father. And he did it through tears and prayers and supplication and much crying. And so if I look for it doctrinally, I'll look around me and I'll be seeking after the group that I believe are the closest to the truth, closest to the faith as I believe it to be. Only to discover, as I'm on my journey, that I'm looking in the wrong place. I'm looking in the doctrinal understandings of men. I can come back to the scriptures and I can look at those and I can say, I'm of the true faith because of this, 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 and this, and this. Only to find that something is revealed to me a little bit later on in my understanding of the word that I hadn't seen before. And I don't know about you, but if you're reading the Word of God and studying the Word of God, you're going to come upon many things in here that change as you mature in your Christian life. They don't change in the sense of become something different, but they change in your life because you didn't see them before. I remember one of my teachers at Bible College says, as soon as you record something or write something, it's dated, and sometime later on, you'll be wondering why you ever said it and why you ever taught it. And he was right. Growing in Christ is to come under his lordship and learn as you go on. Otherwise, you end up in a place I like to refer to as Groundhog Day, where you cannot grow beyond a certain place because doctrinally there's a limitation. Because our forefathers in this particular faith already had defined the parameters within that faith which we must not go beyond. And they had a greater understanding of the word, and so they knew the Greek better and they knew the Hebrew better. And this is the definement that you must stay within. This is the confinement you must stay within. This is the boundary you must stay within. You can't go beyond that. And if you do, you're a heretic. I know all this from experience, not only in my own life, but I have seen it in the lives of so many others as well. And just as John Bunyan discovered, when he was preaching, he had worked it all out. He had it down to a finite perception. He had it down to the actual truth. And he was out telling people about this and preaching Jesus on the streets. And he suddenly came across two women he hadn't seen before, and they were sitting on the steps. He was going to evangelize them and bring them to the truth. And he sat down alongside of them as they were conversing with one another, waiting for them to pause so he could begin to talk. And they continued to talk while he sat there. And after some time they concluded, and they looked around at him. And he realized they were talking about Jesus in a way he had never possibly thought could happen. They were talking about the love they had for the Jesus he didn't know. So he wanted to know more from them. And that's when he began to realize that what he had found so far was nothing. And he began to preach differently and do things differently. And he got put in prison for many, many, many years, and he wrote the book Pilgrim's Progress, which is one of the best sellers in the world every year. And I've read it many times, and I think it's a wonderful book because it shows that we're progressing all the time. So one faith is the exercise of Christ's faith in us. We're allowing ourselves to believe that what we have in Christ Jesus' calling is the true faith. But we can't define it by saying it's with the Catholics, or with it's the Church of Christers, or whether it's the Baptists, or whether it's with the AOG, or whether it's with the Foursquare, or whether it's with the Amish or others. Because that limits us. And we stay within those parameters. We're boxed in. And the Holy Spirit can't work in us. Can't liberate us, can't take us to places where there's no possibility of practicing the pattern of the Baptists, the pattern of the Catholics, by that I mean the doctrinal pattern, or the pattern of the Church of Christ, or the pattern of the AOG. Because he wants us to go off into the jungles of Borneo, or Sumatra, or into some village in Africa where there isn't anybody, or some small town in my state, Western Australia, where there isn't anybody, like we found down there in the country, and God's now doing something there. There were no parameters there. We were it. We were called the God Squad because they didn't have any others in town. And they wanted a church, and they didn't want to come along, but they wanted a church because they felt more secure if they knew there was a church in the town. And surprisingly, in recent days, there's been a lot of survey on this, and people in Australia don't want to necessarily be Christians, but they sure want a Christian community within their community so that they can feel secure knowing there's a Christian group. Surprising, isn't it? And yet, when we come along and we're divided, and there's 14 different churches in the town of 5,000 people, they wonder what's going on. Well, those people have defined their church as the one. And they try and get together, they try and harmonize, they try and have fellowship together, and it's okay for a day's seminar or a meeting of some kind or outreach to the community. But then the question comes up, and if we see souls won, which church are they going to go to? You see, that's immediately worldly. The carnality begins to happen. But if we're in the Holy Spirit and we're trusting there is one Spirit, we would say, allow the Holy Spirit to define that. Allow the Holy Spirit to take control of that. And then the Holy Spirit would work with those people as well as with the leaders of the group in that town or the gathering of the people in that town. And they would also have that one Spirit living within them, and they would have that one faith living within them. They would have the one Lord living within them. Then he talks about one baptism. This is an issue for a lot of people. What baptism is he referring to here? Is he referring to immersion in water? Is he referring to sprinkling, which is not baptism, by the way, it's riptism or ripto, and it means to sprinkle. Riptizo, to sprinkle, baptizo, to baptize by immersion and submersion, and then they talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He says there is one baptism. From the time of John, and through the discipleship program with Jesus for 3.5 years, and following up, the Holy Spirit was poured out for all flesh, that all flesh may partake of it. The baptism that was common in the first century was immersion. It was immersion. It was going on 400 years before John the Baptist began to teach. And he came to the Jews and said they'd gone so far away from God they also need to be baptized, just as the Gentiles were, on the issue of faith. Then Jesus was baptized by immersion. Then they went out and they baptized continually by immersion. And by about the 14th century, when you had King Henry VIII deciding that he's going to take control and separate people from Catholic Church because he wanted to have more wives, sprinkling is introduced, because that would then define those children as Catholics or those children as Church of England. And so sprinkling was introduced so that no one could make a major decision later on in their life and be immersed. Catholic Catechism clearly states that if you have not been immersed, you have committed a mortal sin. So immersion was the practice even amongst the Catholics. It was the practice from the first century onwards. And so when he's referring here to immersion or baptism, is it in water or is it in the Spirit? Jesus referred to the fact that being born from above involved being born of the water and the Spirit. To me, and from what I see in the scripture, is when one is immersed in water, as Jesus was, comes out of the water, as Jesus did, the Holy Spirit comes into that person's life at the same time and takes up residence, as we saw earlier, that Spirit, that one Spirit, takes up residence in that person. Now, he remains either active or latent, which we've been talking about tonight. If the Holy Spirit is active in our lives, he's leading, he's guiding, he's driving us towards earnestness, to eagerly strive for the things of God, and to be harmonious in love with one another, and to let Jesus be the Lord of your life. He's active in your life, and if you're wanting that, you will grow and mature. If you're not wanting that, you'll sit there in a church and you won't do much. Then one day, Lord willing, you hear a sermon, you see a passage, and suddenly you're on fire for the Lord. And spiritual things begin to grow in your heart and in your mind, and suddenly you also experience the power of the Holy Spirit, the empowering of the Holy Spirit, the leading of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And you think that you've had a baptism of the Holy Spirit, as it's referred to. Some people say, well, I'll pray for you that you'll be baptized in the Spirit. I'm not one who believes that. I believe it all happens when you're baptized in water. That happens. The Spirit comes to live within you, the clean new temple. But what happens, I believe, is suddenly when you think all that this baptism of the Holy Spirit is inferring is simply an awakening of the Holy Spirit in your life. Instead of him being latent and living within you, he's suddenly alive because you're letting him have his way in your life. You are no longer quenching the Holy Spirit. You're no longer restricting the Holy Spirit. You're saying, here I am, Lord, use me. I am available to you. Now, I know there are those out there that don't follow that particular interpretation. Fine, we don't have to disagree about it. All I'm concerned about is to get up and get going. That's more important than anything else. How you want to define it is not a problem with me. I define it the way I've just defined it. You might define it some other way, because suddenly you might have a prophecy, or you might have a dream, or you might have a vision that becomes common, or you may even speak in a foreign language, or you may, as we call it, a tongue. And it may not be a foreign language, it may be something else. And you might get all excited all about this, and then suddenly you believe you've had the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I tend to believe it's not. I believe it's awakening of the Holy Spirit. He's always been there. He's always been in your life. All you've done is make yourself available to him. And I've seen it happen. And it happens in different ways. So, if it's going to be one baptism for me, it refers to baptism in water. Because in that baptism, a lot of things happen. You're buried away in Christ. You're raised to walk in newness of life. The faith of God becomes active in your life. You have your sins washed away. Acts chapter 2, 20, chapter 22, verse 16. Acts 2, 38. Romans 6, 1 through 4. All of these are referable to the scriptures. So baptism here to me means immersion in water. I threw a cat amongst the pigeons, didn't I? And of course in verse 6 he then goes on and says, one God and Father of us all, who is above all, sovereign over all, pervading all and living in us all. James refers to that as being the very effulgence of God himself in chapter 3 and verse 9. We are the effulgence of God. We are the very essences, the very substance of God himself. And that is true because he spoke all things into existence. And we were made out of that which he spoke into existence. And then he took that innate clay and breathed into it a living soul. And that clay became Adam. And so you have a living soul with a body, not a body with a living soul. You have a living soul with a body. which is the very image of God. Let us make man in our image. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, the Lord, 26, sorry. The Lord said that. He said that very thing. Let us make man in our image. Who's the us he's referring to? He's referring to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who are all one. Now, this is where you get into the trilogy that people like to talk about. There has to be this three, which we call the Trinity, right? But it's really a trilogy, if you like. There are three doing certain things, or is there one doing three different things? It becomes confusing to a lot of people. The easiest place to define the Trinity, and you can't use that really, because there's no reference in the Bible to a Trinity. It's just a word defining three in action. But if we refer to it as the Godhead, in Genesis chapter 1, the Godhead said, let us make man in our image. And in 1 Corinthians 12, verses 4, 5, and 6, you will see there that the Father is the master architect, the Son is the supervisor, the Holy Spirit provides the tools, and the Christian is the worker. We are the effervescence of God, you like. We are the very effulgence of His glory. We are the very outspring of His love and grace and mercy. Of His very nature, we are to the world. So when we fight with one another, when we argue with one another, we're arguing with our Father. Because He's in you as He is in me. He said that right there. He said He's above all, over all, pervading all, and living in us all. So every time I get into envy and jealousy and lust and fornication or whatever, adultery and greed and so on, and I bring it upon my brothers and sisters in the church or any man or woman anywhere, what I'm doing it is I'm violating this relationship I have with my Father. And that's why the devil wants us all to be at war with one another. Because he wants the image of God wiped off the face of the earth. This is why scientists are so deluded with their attempts to clone human beings and to bring about their creation. They're striving as hard as they can to create life so they can say they're God. There was a movie just produced about that recently called Lucy. And it's an interesting science fiction about a particular woman. Lucy refers, of course, to the first ape-type woman they found in Africa, remember? They found that skeleton that was a million years old and so on in Africa, and she was called Lucy. Well, this movie is about modern-day Lucy, who suddenly begins to use 100% of her brain capacity. And most of us only use 10% of our brain capacity. But she finds a way in which she can suddenly begin to grow and mature into 100% of her brain capacity. And it's quite alarming what goes on in this movie. And it's somewhat affront to you because you have a relationship with God and you have a faith. So I was uncomfortable at the very beginning of this movie, watching what was going on. But at the very end, I rejoiced because it proved one thing. Exactly what the devil said to Adam and Eve in the garden. If you eat of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will become as God. At the very end of the movie, she gains 100% of the capacity of her brain. And the question is asked, where do we go from here? And she says, I am God. I will help you. You see, what man is striving to do is to become God. And he realized, these scientists who wrote, or whoever wrote this movie, realized that if man reached the fullness of the capacity of his brain use, he could be as God. And so you see how hypocritical it is for the world to believe all this stuff, how deceived the world is, that education is the answer. Elitism is the answer, totalitarian is the answer, one person in control is the answer. It's all satanic. It all stems back from the deception of the garden. And so when we refer here to one God, we're talking about the Godhead. We're talking about the Godhead. You have the Father, who is able to do all things. You have the Son, who has his responsibilities. You have the Holy Spirit, who has his responsibility, and they all agree together. They are all one. And if you want to understand what the Godhead refers to, this oneness means just like a company. If you have a company structure and three of you agree to form a company, one is involved in the manufacturing, one is involved in the marketing, one is involved in the delivery or service. And yet, if you were to ask any one of those three directors, is this your company? They would have to say yes, because they have a joint agreement to be one company. But they all have different functions. The Father has a different function from the Son. The Son submits to the Father. We know that from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In the end, when all is done, that is in the authority of the Son, he hands it all back to the Father, and we all become one together with him in the kingdom of God. And so I don't have any problem with saying one God. I don't have one being doing three things. We have three beings making up the Godhead who all have comparable responsibility for what is a functioning Godhead. Each one is able to be claimed, I am God. Because they are. Because they're all doing the same thing. Complicated theology. Let's move on. One God and Father of us all. Now, the biggest problem I hear today is because of the broken families that exist, a lot of people have a great difficulty having a father-son relationship. They have this lack of father input into their lives. So when they get converted, they have a great difficulty accepting God as their father because their own fathers didn't set a good example. And so if you come into the LGBTI, homosexual relationship, same-sex marriage type relationship, there will be one partner who isn't matching up to the responsibilities of a father or a mother in that child's life, because you have two fathers, you have two mothers, they don't get the male input, they don't get the female input, depending on who they're living with. And so they are not in any way properly programmed to meet life in society. And that's another deception from the evil one. Confuse them about their gender. Jesus quite clearly said, he who made them in the beginning made them of the gender of male and of the gender of female and joined them together that they should be one. Let no gender separate them. He said, let no man separate them. But the intent is no gender should interfere with the gender relationship that God made normal, which was male and female. But they're trying to teach the world that you have a gender by birth, but you may have a gender by emotion or feeling that is different from the body that you're living in, and it's okay for you then to go and live the way you want to be. If you want to be a girl, you can be a girl. You have to shave every day, but you can be a girl. And then if you want to be a man, you're going to have to learn how to grow a beard, or you're going to have to learn how to dress like a man and act like a man. But when you're born a man, you're acting naturally. It's your environment that brings about all that confusion. And so if you come into a relationship where there's a weak man, or he's left and run off with someone else, and you don't have a father image, you have a problem with that. So we're dealing in society with a confused race of people who are getting more confused every day. And those who are confused are wanting to tell our children and our grandchildren about how confused they are when they're not confused. But they go home to mum and dad and their normal relationship, and then they wonder, why is my friend living with two ladies, calling one mum and the other one something else? Or living with two men, he's got two dads. They come home, they ask mum and dad, and because mum and dad want to be politically correct, they say, oh, it doesn't matter, it's okay, they love one another, it's all right. As long as you love one another, it's okay. But it isn't okay, because it doesn't allow you to be responsible in your life at the time that you need to be responsible. When you get converted, you come into this situation, you can't relate to God as your father because you didn't have a father in your life. Big problem. Or you didn't have a mother in your life, so you can't relate to women. You have a problem relating to women. Confusion was never part of God's plan, and it never will be, and especially in that area. And he says here, who is above all? Everything that needs to be dealt with in our life is dealt with one who is above all. He's over the whole lot. He's so sovereign over all. He is pervading all. Everything that is living on the face of the earth or not living on the face of the earth is pervaded by God. And he's living in us all. When we become Christians, we begin to know that. We begin to understand that. If you're not converted and you're just a churchgoer, you will never be able to experience the very living presence of God in your life because you haven't been taught how to make yourself available to him to do that. If you're just there as a Christian from a theological point of view, or from a stick up your hand, bow your head, close your eyes and go to church and have a good time point of view, you'll never have that intimate relationship with the living God in your life where you can say, this is what God did with me this week. I know God was in that this week. I was doing this and suddenly this happened and this occurred and I know that God put it all together. God made it happen. In other words, you don't have that personal relationship with the living God. You have a theological relationship and it's going to be dead. It's going to be Groundhog Day. Every week it'll have to be the same. Otherwise you'll think you'll be lost because you're under the law of this theology. Might as well go back to the Old Testament and live under those principles of the Torah that completely bonded you up and didn't give you liberty. But Paul wrote about that in Galatians and Romans and said, don't live like that. Be free from that. Live like this, where God is over all, through all, and in all, and including in us, living his life, his way. Amen.